Hi, I'm Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor of computer science and psychology, and I've been a faculty member for over 5 years. I wanted to talk to you a bit today about a topic that can be challenging to discuss with a potential advisor, but it is useful to have this information going in. And it is about what is the deal with PhD funding anyway? Now, most people, when they're thinking about applying to different programs, they're thinking about a massive cost that would incur to them. Oftentimes for your undergraduate degree, you're talking about thousands of dollars. For master's degrees, also thousands of dollars as well. So it can be very uncomfortable when thinking, do I want to go into a PhD program because I might be in debt till I die because of the expense of this particular degree? Well, that is actually not the case. And I wanted to talk to you today about how funding works, where it comes from, and how to navigate this. I've talked about this in a few videos already, but the way that it works is for your PhD program, when you are admitted, you get a contract, and the contract lists the exact salary that you get. That salary dollar is the amount of money that you take home after taxes and everything else, but it does not include your tuition. The program always covers your tuition. So that will be covered right out of the gate. And that is already, you know, thousands upon thousands of dollars that you're getting off. So that's one expense that you're not going to have. And then you get a separate salary that you take home. Now there's a few ways that you might be required to get that salary. One is to be a teaching assistant. This is where you support a professor in a class, and that is your formal job, and you have to do that for part-time. So you can do that a maximum of 20 hours per week, and you will be assigned to a course if that is the funding mechanism that you're under. Now, that is usually the default, unless your advisor, who you're applying to work with directly, has separate money for you. And there's a few places where that money can come from. One is they might have money in what's called a startup. When you start at a new university, they give you a big chunk of money to get you going, to start up your lab, to hire students, etc. So they might have that money that they're allocating to you, and that's a limited pot of funds. They might have also received a grant, and there's many grants that professors get from a wide range of sources. So if you get that type of grant funding, you'll be expected to work on a grant-related project because they're getting the money to do a particular type of research, and they need your support in that. So you're getting work to be a researcher, and that is for 20 hours a week as well. So you get the salary that is in the contract that you're sent before you are admitted into the program, and that salary will either be covered with grants or by you being a teaching assistant, both of which are 20 hours per week, the rest of the time you'll spend on your courses. So that's a pretty good deal for a part-time job to both have all the tuition for your courses covered and salary. But you might want to know, what is the actual salary? So I have here a CS stipend rankings, and there are various other websites you can go to. I'm in computer science, so I know a little bit more about that. And it gives you a sense of what average salaries are at different universities. And what we have here is a system where they take the stipends minus the cost of living, and they show you, you know, the kind of the calculus after that is equated for, which doesn't look great if you see all these reds here. But what this will help you do is look at which universities, A, give you the highest stipends, and how that relates to the cost of living in those particular areas. In particular, you might take a look at some of these more lower ranked in terms of the salary to stipend calculus or calculation here. And just be careful, because in some of those places, it could be truly hard to live as a graduate student on that particular salary. What is also nice to do is you can just sort it by the stipend and look at which places have the highest stipends. So these are some excellent places to go to, but take into account the cost of living in those areas. So this is pretty standard, but there is a big range, right? At the top, we have 52K from Stanford. At the bottom, from Rochester, we have 21. That is a big range. This is, you know, double. So you could be pretty strapped if you're at one of the places that has lower stipends as a graduate student. So just keep that in mind. While those, you know, all these are clearly in the red, what these aren't taking into account is that your tuition is also being covered. So, you know, while it's pretty hard to live in these places off the salaries that you're getting, and I was a graduate student myself, so I know, you're not paying at all for your tuition. And truly, I was shocked when I heard that. I have come from a very blue-collar family, and I was astonished that someone was going to pay my tuition. So that was really exciting news for me that I didn't know coming in. Okay, but who actually pays these salaries? By and large, it will be your advisor covering 50%, if not all, of the amount of money that you get paid taking home. So you have to consider that when you're applying to different places, that some advisors will have more money than others based on their grant funding, or if they're new to a particular place and they have a startup. So you will be more successful in getting into places where an advisor has more money. Maybe they have a track record of getting grants, or maybe that they're new to a particular institution, so they have some of those funds. In any case, they are going to be the gatekeepers of the funds because they had to get it from the government or write all these, you know, extra grants to get money. So if you need other types of equipment or you need money to travel, etc., it's going to go through them. So they're essentially writing these major grants to get money to pay you to do work and to be supported in your research. So that covers most of what I wanted to talk about, in the sense that money comes primarily from your advisors, which is why it's so important to get to know who the advisors are before you're applying, to de-risk yourself, make sure that you're worth that money that they're spending on you. But the last thing I wanted to talk about is what happens if the funding runs out. There could be a case where your advisor doesn't get any more grants, and maybe they accepted too many students. And that can be very, very stressful for students because they feel like they're gonna have to pay for their courses themselves, something like that. Well, the way that it works, and I've seen this happen several times, is that the number of funded years you have on your contract when you sign up is guaranteed. It is guaranteed in that letter. So someone, your advisor, the institution, the school, whatever, they will find the money to pay you through that time period, okay? Different offers have different guaranteed funding periods. Sometimes they say first year, 2, 3, 4, all the way up to 5 years, okay? So generally what you see is students being covered in terms of their tuition and their salary up to 5 years, and sometimes to their sixth year. We generally try to keep students to complete their PhD in 5 years, in part because it starts to add up when we're still paying, you know, people beyond that period of time. But let's say your contract said 4 years and your advisor doesn't have any more funds. I have almost always seen it where the department comes together and they find money for those students. It isn't guaranteed, it's at the kind of will of a particular department, but it tends to be what I see, is everyone bands together and finds a way to fund a student. Now, with that said, a way to ease some of this pressure is to get some funding yourself. There are many dissertation awards that you can apply to that will fund you in that last year. An NSF GRFP will fund you, I think, for 3, maybe 4 years. So then if you get one of those, you know, you can stay for probably 6 years. They will likely find money for you, given that you've already covered the first part of your tuition and salary. But there's other smaller grants that you can kind of piece together to make that up as well. But truly what happens is if you are in that year that is not contractually covered, they may run out of money. But the benefit is that the way that PhD programs are generally structured is that you will have completed your coursework in the first 2, max 3 years. So by the fourth, fifth, and sixth years, you will not be taking courses, okay, generally. That means that you're not paying for all of those credits if you do have to be funding it yourself. You generally do have to pay, you have to pay the student fees, which can add up. That's usually several thousands of dollars. And maybe there might be a minimum number of credits that you have to take to be an active student. That tends to be 3 credits. So in worst case scenario, you're talking about paying the student fees, which is several hundred dollars to several thousands of dollars, and potentially paying for 3 credits, which could be maybe about $6,000-ish. And that's the worst case scenario. And that's what you'd be paying per semester. So hopefully that doesn't happen to you. I've actually never seen it happen. I have lots of friends in academia, and you know, we've never seen that happen. But if you're really worried about the financial situation, that would be the worst case scenario. I hope this information was helpful. I know I was sort of rambling a bit, but I think the important parts are that whatever is in your contract is guaranteed. And what I told you about today is the back end, kind of what's happening with the advisor, who's sorting out the money, if you want to know. But truly, you don't have to care about any of that, because on your end, you will get a salary and you will either be a teaching assistant or a research assistant, and that's all you really need to know about. If you get into those later years, which I encourage you not to do, I encourage you to try to finish in 5 years, in part so you don't deal with these funding issues. But if you do, it will work out as well. So please, please do not let financial fears be a reason not to do a PhD. In part because if you think about it just from a financial position, it is a job. It is a job, and you can see this, the salaries in different cities. So if you're willing to do a job for this salary, it is a fantastic job that is so incredibly rewarding. That will give you so much after once you graduate. It will forever be giving to you. And of course, you get free tuition, which is an amazing blessing. I hope that was helpful. If you have any more questions about academia, being in PhD programs, please comment down below and take care.